in the Queen's funeral. And what an extraordinary few days it's been for her. But as we watch the pictures of the hearse getting nearer and nearer to Windsor, it is a sense of the Queen coming home to Windsor. Wilfred quite rightfully said that Balmoral had a very, very special place in the Queen's heart, somewhere that she would spend her summer holidays. But in many ways, Windsor was her sort of home away from home. It was the one that she spent at weekends at most often. And it has an astonishing history. Windsor is the oldest and largest continuously inhabited castle in the world, with 1,000 rooms, 150 staff, and somewhere that she really loved. She had lots of her hobbies at Windsor. She has a collection of budgerigars, the little birds at Windsor, and she took great delight in visiting them, particularly as she got older. And the hearse that we're looking at there, guys, I don't know if you can see it, the picture there, there's a little sort of statuette attached to the front of the bonnet of the car, and that was one of the many things the Queen designed herself. It is St. George slaying the dragon on the front. You can just see it behind the middle police outrider there. And of course, she is going to be laid in rest in St. George's Chapel. These things are not coincidences. They're very, very deliberate. St. George being also the patron saint, not just of England, but also the patron saint of soldiers. So another nod towards the huge responsibility she took as commander-in-chief there. This hearse that she designed with Jaguar Land Rover, with these extra large windows. And as we saw when the hearse took her to Buckingham Palace when she was flown down from Scotland, it has these spotlights inside the hearse. So even when night falls, if she was going to be in the hearse, the public would still be able to see her. So many small nods. She designed the colour. I don't know if you remember, but Prince Philip's hearse that was a converted Land Rover was in his official colours that his staff wore, which was this military green, but hers is in the royal claret colour. Many people surprised that the hearse is in black, but it's not. It's a very dark red colour. So lots and lots of instances. And one of the...
So, there are so many wonderful home movies Princess Elizabeth and her sister playing there as young kids. I was watching how she learned to ride horses there, how it became just a place for her heart to rest. And I love that. When I thought about that, I thought, what a perfect place for her to be laid to rest.
Arriving here, there'll be several events. A lot of them, almost all of them, 90% of them are going to be public. The entire world is going to be able to see the procession into Windsor Castle, and then also the service at St. George's Chapel as well. All of that will be televised. It'll be the first time people are seeing this since her father, King George VI, was memorialized here as well, going back years now. And so
along the way, they haven't appreciably everywhere. Virtually everywhere this procession has transferred through, we have seen large crowds. Here's just a few people on the sides here, but
hearing about the fire at Windsor Castle, I'm reminded that I believe 1992 was the year that the Queen referred to as the, and I won't pronounce it correctly, Annus Horribilis. My Latin is not as good as hers, but it was part of a period of time that she was so transparent about being difficult for her family on a multitude of levels. And Wilfred, as we remember the Queen and honor her service, it bears noting that she herself went through challenges, and the monarchy went through moments of tremendous challenge.
Absolutely, and I think, you know, that decade itself, that entire decade was...
Put her in that role, something that Camilla will now do for King Charles as we move forwards.
There have been so many grace notes today, Victoria, including the jewelry that the Duchess of Sussex, Meghan, has chosen to wear. Of course, the Princess of Wales, Catherine, which she chose to wear. And even the littlest royal we have with us today, 7-year-old Charlotte.
Indeed, they're all making that jewellery link to the Queen. Of course, she was a great wearer of jewellery herself, always kind of seen in her brooches and her pearls. Meghan wore a pair of earrings that the Queen gifted her. Kate was wearing a pair of earrings as well that were on loan from the Queen, and also a pearl and diamond choker which had been seen on Her Majesty previously. And most touchingly, I think, this is the first time we saw Charlotte wearing jewellery. And it was a very petite piece. It was a small horseshoe-shaped brooch just on her lapel. And it's believed to have been given to her by the Queen as a gift. Of course, the love of horses that perhaps Charlotte will continue one day.
And Victoria, just a word on the people who have come from far away. They've spent hours online in a queue. They are standing right now waiting as the hearse drives by. It's very personal. It really struck me how personal this is for the people who are watching.
It is, and I think that's just a testament to how the Queen made them to not only pay their respects, but to be part of history. I think that's the thing that struck me the most. They really wanted to be part of this day, this historic event, which we are really not going to see on a scale like this probably ever again, I would say, the way that the monarchy will move forwards. So for them to come out, to spend their precious time queuing, waiting, that is really significant, and I think testament to the respect people felt for the Queen.
Just watching on the full screen to see how close actually that coffin is getting to the Long Walk. The Long Walk, as we've discussed, is this huge road that leads straight into Windsor Castle, and we've just gotten word actually they have closed down the Long Walk to any additional mourners. It is absolutely packed. I can't even try to estimate how many tens of thousands of people are here. People have been here, Lester, since the wee hours. We got here pretty early this morning, and there were already people in their camping chairs camped out. And just to emphasize what Hoda and Susanna were just talking about, it is just a split second. People are waiting for just a moment to watch the coffin pass. And everyone is kind of in the last half hour because they know it's getting close, jamming up against these barriers right here. But the coffin, we will have ample warning, Lester, because it will come up and over a hill behind me. We will see it travel the 2.64 miles all the way to Cambridge Gate. I'm just going to flip around the camera just so you can get a sense. You see children on shoulders. You see families. Everyone is craning their neck to get a glimpse at these big screens to see and try to estimate just how close it is. It will then go into the Cambridge Gates and make its way the whole convoy, make its way to the quadrangle, and that's where we'll see that procession start. But Lester, we'll keep you posted as soon as we get a glimpse that it's coming over the hill, and I'm sure you'll hear the crowds here. Very, very excited.
Yeah, in fact, we're told, as I opened up my mouth to speak, the procession has resumed now, so you should be seeing the procession quite soon. The hearse now, as you can see, partially covered with flowers that people have tossed at it. Gratitude and thanks to their late queen, as it has made its way now to Windsor, about to enter Windsor, where, as Molly showed us, a big crowd ready to welcome the queen.
she took this opportunity to grab the aforementioned aide and hoist him into the heather. There they sort of hid, giggling like teenagers, while this group of tourists passed. You couldn't have that relationship with the Queen, I don't think.
Mr. Abbey.
actually something that is not on camera, just around this corner here, which is in front of Windsor Castle, right across from St. George's Chapel. Since there were no more people allowed in the long walk, people are now surrounding this area. And it's somewhat interesting because, of course, we call this Windsor Castle. It's a place where the royals live. But it's also a fortress. And right now, where they're allowing people, the fortress is surrounded by supporters. They're all out here. They're not even sure if they're going to get a glimpse of anything because of their location where they are. But there have been so many people that have come out to Windsor Castle that they're now just, they just want to be close to the castle. They're not even sure if they're going to see anything. I'm struck by those images. And of course, the images we're seeing here on the screen of the hearse, the state hearse, and how the flowers that were thrown from the crowds landed on that hearse. I mean, you almost couldn't have planned this more perfectly. I mean, the way they were just sort of ushered on top of the glass back of that hearse, and of course on top of the hood, and all the flowers throughout Windsor Castle right now. When we take those wide aerial shots, you can see rows of green, but those are all flowers on the floor as well, as the Grenadier Guards are protecting the state hearse as it's about to enter St. George's Chapel. So as we look at the crown there, the scepter, and the orb, we're going to see those removed from the coffin and placed on St. George's altar. Included in those items, some of the world's largest diamonds, and so much history there. Priceless artifacts there. We're talking about a diamond that has more than 500 carats in that scepter alone. So we're about to witness history right here, Lester. We're about to witness something we probably are not going to see again in our lifetimes, most likely, as the state hearse here is entering and getting approaching closer and closer to St. George's Chapel. Lester?
to commit into the hands of God the soul of his servant Queen Elizabeth. Here in St. George's Chapel, where she so often worshipped, we are bound to call to mind someone whose uncomplicated yet profound Christian faith bore so much fruit. Fruit in a life evinced in the wider world, but also and especially to be remembered in this place, in kindness, concern, and reassuring care for her family and friends and neighbors. In the midst of our rapidly changing and frequently troubled world, her calm and dignified presence has given us confidence to face the future as she did, with courage and with hope. As with grateful hearts, we reflect on these and all the many other ways in which her long life has been a blessing to us, we pray that God will give us grace to honor her memory by following her example, and that with our sister Elizabeth, at the last, we shall know the joys of life eternal. And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away. And he that sat upon the throne said, Behold, I make all things new. And he said to me, Write, for these words are true and faithful. And he said unto me, It is done. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. I will give unto him that is athirst of the fountain of the water of life freely. He that overcometh shall inherit all things, and I will be his God, and he shall be my son.
Before our eyes. Above all, we rejoice at thy gracious promise to all thy servants, living and departed, that we shall rise again at the coming of our Saviour Jesus Christ. We pray that in due time we may share with our sister that clearer vision, when we shall see thy face in the same Jesus Christ our Lord.
O Father of all, we pray to thee for those whom we love but see no longer. Grant them peace, let light perpetual shine upon them, and in thy loving wisdom and almighty power, work in them the good purposes of thy perfect will. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive them that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Well, for this is the ultimate symbolism of the moment.
It really is, and her crown is being removed from her coffin. It of course now belongs to her son, King Charles III, though it will not, in fact, sit atop his head until his coronation. as you said, this is it all. This is the history right now. Just one him remaining before she'll be lowered.
The Dean of Windsor will place those royal ornaments onto the altar.
We will also hear the Garter King of Arms announce all of Queen Elizabeth II's titles. One final time, titles that will themselves pass on to her son.
Wilfred, explain what we just saw there, the breaking of a wand.
Yes, so first the king placed the Queen's company camp colour of the Grenadier Guards. I think as you said there, we could see the weight of duty but also sadness on his face. And as he and his family depart,